closed session, and there was no action taken. And we will now go to commissioner's comments. Anybody have any comments?
I've got a stack of stuff here. I hate to do it.
Oh, my goodness.
I'm hungry, too.
I am, too.
First question, Susan. We got this letter March 4th about the social services registering people to vote and all that. And I hate that you even have to do it. I think it's terrible that our government thinks that's the place to do it. Shows you how desperate some in government are to get voters, especially of certain ranks. But what do you and your department, not to get into what you, what they're criticizing versus your answers, because, you know, I feel for you anyway, having to do this, but when somebody registers to vote over at social services, and if they, what do y'all tell them? I mean, I'm sure, I mean, you got the formality, but do you get in explaining what voting is, or
no.
Do you get in explaining what party is, and so forth and so on?
We have a script that the State Board of Elections has, and basically if someone were to ask, we ask them if they're registered to vote. If they say no, we say we have available the forms. We give them a form. If they need we ask them if they need assistance in filling it out. If they don't need assistance filling it out, they fill it out, we turn it into the local
board.
But
you actually hand everybody.
Well, if they say they're not registered to vote, we hand everybody who says they're not registered to vote one. Now, if you came in this morning and you applied for food stamps and we ask you, are you registered to vote? And you said, no, I'd like to register. And we hand you a form and we ask you if you need assistance. If you don't, you fill it out, we take it, we turn it in. And you come back this afternoon to apply for Medicaid. We are required by law, and we do keep a tracking record of your voter registration. So we would have in our computer system that you registered this morning. So we would not give you another form, which is the reason that the State Board of Elections says that we need to give somebody another form.
What if they just stand there and say, you know, you ask me, and I say, no, I'm not registered to vote. I don't know. What do you do at that point?
Would you like to register today?
And so you come back with that.
Yes, sir. And if you say, no, I wouldn't, then we are required to say, would you like to take your form home?
Okay. I'd like to see the script that the state's
asked
you to go
through. Sure.
Now, number two, can statistics be gotten as to the how people are registering, not by name, but by statistics on what party they're registering?
And that would be, they're not, to my knowledge, they're not identified when they're turned in. They're a 1, 2, or 3, and a 1 is social services, I think, and a 2 is, that's 1, 2, and 3 identifies them. They're not identified by county, but the local board of elections gets them all. Our local board gets them.
So there's no way that our local board could tell us whether 95% of your registrations over there are Democrat or Republican?
I honestly don't know. But I'd be glad to talk to Kathy. Don't know the answer to that.
That information is available.
Sure. I know they're not identified.
By name.
Right.
Or
by county.
Yeah,
we send them to the local
board.
Well,
maybe it's the state you'd have to add. I like to know the statistics on you know, local and state, if we can get it.
Okay.
I just think it's pathetic that you have to do it.
It is.
And we are complying with the law. What we're not doing is mailing, printing. We have the declination preference form in our Northwood system. They fill it out. We weren't having them sign it, but they're signing it now on a computer pad, and we're saving those in the computer system. Now, the one thing we're not doing is, in trying to save money and be efficient, we're not printing them and then storing them in the basement and shredding them in 2 years. So they're available. We track every person. But I'll get you the script and
you will.
Try to get the numbers for you.
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome.
Second issue is, I'm embarrassed to say, at least I'm honest about it, that I just saw a memo, was cleaning out some stuff here recently, and I don't know how I missed it, December the 3rd date, and I don't want to identify it a whole lot, but I talked to Jason about it. It was a permit that we were granting, or somebody was inquiring about, to be able to operate something. And I have reason to think that you might not have legal citizens going through our government agency here getting permits for things. And so I asked Jason, is he still here? I asked Jason, did we identify these people? Did we ask for picture IDs or, you know? My point is I can't imagine that we do anything granting permits, and Clyde, we've talked about this before as far as what we can do and can't do, but that we do anything without identifying people. Is there any rule that we can't, it says that we could not require a picture ID for people to obtain permits from the county for various things, no matter what the issue is?
You could ask for a picture ID or a Department of Motor Vehicle ID. Make sure that's the person that's applying for the permit. If there's a license required, you can ask for a license. Mm-hmm. Electrician, plumber.
Mm-hmm. But we're not doing it now, is my understanding.
At least not in this. As far as professional business licenses, they are. As far as your HVAC license or a plumber's license.
The permitting department does that. Process. Yes.
Okay. On that, now this Jason was without identifying anything. I don't think that's improper. I think it's ethical. This was to an application for a watershed permit. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And it was quite a large one. People say that I and others stereotype things too much, but when you can statistically prove that you're right more than wrong on some of your analyses, I don't think it's stereotyping. I just think it's doing things that we ought to be doing in this country. And Jason, you know what I'm talking about, and I wish y'all could see if there's something we can do. And if it's not just in your department, if it's some other departments, we need to be identifying people when they walk in for something. I don't think you can go over here and get a gun permit and tell them you're somebody that you're not, or that you're, I think you have to prove within some reason that you're who you are and that you're a legal resident. Criminal record. I'm not saying we have to do all that for everybody, but I just think it's willy-nilly what I just inquired about tonight. So y'all could pursue that a little further. In the third angle issue here, I saw what Guilford County had that they had submitted for a resolution about the county line. They're requesting this Senate bill. Is that?
Yes.
You're familiar with all this?
Yes. It's similar to the one that we're proposing.
They're suggesting that they're trying to get a resolution passed that the county line is the geodetic line.
That's correct.
Guilford Alamance. Okay. Now, is that line over there not possibly, it could be zigzagged as well if they didn't do that. Is that correct?
It matches more closely the U.S. geological line, mm-hmm, than the Alamance Orange line.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't have a group of citizens that have claimed that for the last 30 years they've lived in a different county. It's a different situation.
But they do have some situations where they're allowing taxes to be paid.
They passed a resolution in December of 07, December 13th, where they made a resolution that they would not collect taxes if they were in dispute. But Alamance has already, I think, been collecting those taxes, and that's part of the reason for that special local legislation, so that those citizens don't get discovered and charged a penalty for the taxes that they have not paid or had paid in the wrong county for the last 3 years.
Who's submitting that for them, one of their local legislators?
They have a delegation that is going to present that, the Guilford delegation. Probably in conjunction with our delegation, if we get Orange on board with that, all three delegations represent that. But it protects their commissioners, it protects their citizens, and allows a transition period.
And this is basically, their local bill is basically what Clyde came up with, and Clyde gave them the same draft that we gave Orange County.
Right.
The issue we're having with Orange County right now, the local bill, is they want it less detailed. Guilford County was okay with adding the more detailed part of the bill. Orange County's wanting like a page. So it's a, they're trying to simplify it, we think, a little bit too much.
Our bill covers voter registration, the clerk of court, the register of deeds, where a property might have been registered in an incorrect county. It also covers the issue of the schools. And it was an all-encompassing local legislation, also protecting the commissioners from any personal liability on the tax code for not collecting taxes for the last 3 years. Especially important for Guilford, because they have a resolution instructing their tax collector not to collect those taxes. So Mark Payne is the new attorney over there, and he and I met, and we talked about it, and I sent him the draft. Sent the same draft that we sent to Orange, that we've been working on with Orange, and we feel like we've got a very good workable piece of local legislation that will pass and provide everybody the protection they need. I think it will be interesting to see Thursday night what happens in Guilford. But Mark believes that he's got the votes to get it passed there.
Now, what is that bill more or less similar to what Wake and Franklin's doing?
Their resolution, the Guilford resolution, is a lot like our initial resolution. Straight line, with no deviation. That's okay. The Guilford resolution, plus the local legislation. So they're trying to keep it simple and just get it done.
Okay. Lastly, I got one more thing. I don't know if this is apropos or if it's just the sign of the times, but I don't know how many of you saw, and with our budget retreat coming up, I don't want to save it for that day. I think we need to be thinking about this before that day. This was last Saturday's paper. This past Saturday's Raleigh paper, front page, triangle. Wake braces for budget cuts. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you've read that or not, but it's talking about, subtitle, the county expects a shortfall of up to $18 million with no plans to raise taxes. And they're talking about cutting their budget, and I think part of their solution is, you know, I hate to say the word furlough, but furlough some employees. Guilford County. This was Saturday's. It's amazing. Raleigh, front page of their region section, Saturday, this past Saturday, same day, front page, Greensboro News and Record, Guilford County. County cuts costs with furloughs. And then Rockingham County. Now, this is, I told you about Rockingham. Rockingham, this is dated March the 9th, News and Record. Rockingham County to furlough employees. And I'm not saying that in a haughty way, other than to say, it's a sign of the times, and people are addressing it in many different ways. And I'm willing to address it the way I feel like we have to do it, just like you would anywhere else in business or at home or wherever. Now, lastly, Ms. Vaughn, and nicely, I'll ask you something here, or at least try to explain one thing to you if you got any questions. But I understand that you've requested for minutes, goes back 10 years, about who voted for tax increases and who did not. And that's fine, that's public record. But what I would suggest is you, a good bit of that time, you weren't on our board, number one. Number two, a lot of the votes that are for tax increases, the majority that might, point in cases when we had a 3.32 vote over at Williams High School that night. You remember that?
Mm-hmm.
And you and I and John Patterson voted for the given tax increase that we got.
But they were going to double. They were going to raise it 3 cents.
That's
higher,
right,
than that.
Yeah. The two that voted no were wanting to raise taxes even higher.
That's
so
right.
What we were doing was trying to get in there and get the card game in there where we wouldn't get the taxes as high. So you have to understand the flow of the motions and flow of the debate. I will say that I voted, and I'm not ashamed to say it, I'll tell you why I did it. I sat here one night and voted for a half a cent tax increase, half a penny, because we had a commissioner up here, in my opinion, who had told us in a work session that he would support what was on the table. Clearly told us he would support what was on the table at the work session, at the budget retreat. And item by item. And then when we got here to vote, that commissioner just kept voting no or something. I can't remember the whole details, but
I remember that.
Yeah, and to be honest about it, there was a game being played.
Yeah.
And I just couldn't. And I looked down at David Cheek, and I looked at him. I said, I'll vote for a tax increase before I play this game one more vote. And that's exactly what I did. I voted for a half a cent tax increase. And but I don't know your motivation on that, but I would say to you that you got to know the logic of all the votes. And sometimes what appears to be a vote for a tax increase is really a vote to keep it from getting higher, because you had some other people that would have taken it higher had you gone with them.
So yeah, I remember I was sitting right out there when all that happened, wasn't it?
At Williams High School?
No, it was one that happened here.
Yeah, the one that happened here, yeah. Doug Fincannon was here, and yep, then yep. He had the rest of us here. And that was, but there's a story behind every vote. And sometimes what appears to be a yes is really a no, as far as your logic. But plus, sometimes you'll vote for a tax increase because it's mandated, not necessarily mandated, but it's the people have told you to do it. You know, we're going to build a school, or we're going to approve this bond referendum. We've had tax increases because we had to do something that was mandated by a bond referendum. So, but if you have any questions about some of the logic of those votes, I'd be glad to talk to you. Yeah. That's all.
Are you done? Okay. I have one thing.
Okay.
I know, does everybody get this legislative alert? Do you guys get this? Okay. I called Mr. Leonard on this, and you know, we had a resolution from Caldwell County that they wanted us to sign to, when was that, last week, Patty, came in, that resolution against this. And when I talked with Mr. Leonard, this has been put on hold, if you read this. And what it is an act to create a combined motor vehicle registration, renewal, and property tax collection system. Now, I thought to start with that they were going to hoodoo us, okay, and keep the money. But what it is, they're going to collect, the state's going to collect the money for us, and because right now, evidently, we're not collecting that money. And to my understanding, the state's,
we are collecting it, but not at a higher, the statewide average is about 84%.
Right, and we're collecting part of it, but. But now what they want to do is they're putting in a new system, and there's hitches in the system right now, and so they put this on hold for 2 years, okay? I don't know why. The IS might can tell you more than I can, but anyway, I just want y'all to know that we don't need to do that resolution. They've asked us not to do anything. This is through the North Carolina County Commissioners Association, and which is Mr. Leonard is on that, not our Dave Leonard, but anyway, and they do not have a position on it at this point, because there's no need to have a position, because we don't really know what's going to happen. But I did talk with him yesterday, and he said, please do not take any action on Caldwell's resolution. So just want to let y'all know that. So that's why it's not on the agenda. Okay? That's all I have. Anybody else got anything else? Any announcements? All right. We are adjourned.
Okay. 7 o'clock.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.